Welcome all to this service of worship, giving thanks to God for his gifts, his grace, and his loving guidance. As we prepare to enter this service, let us pray. All that is eternal in us welcomes the wonder of this day, the field of brightness it creates, offering time for each thing to arise and illuminate. May we have the courage today to live the life that we would have, to postpone the dream no longer, but do at last what we came here for, and waste our hearts on fear no more. Amen. Our call to worship this morning. How good it is to sing praises to our God. For God is gracious, and a song of praise is fitting. God heals the brokenhearted and binds up the wounds. God is our Lord and abundant in power. God's understanding is beyond measure. Isaiah exclaims, "Have you not known? Have you not heard? The Lord is the everlasting God, the creator of the ends of the earth. God does not faint or grow weary, but rather comes to us to renew our strength. So let us make our confession before God and before one another and find therein our renewed life in God." Let us pray together. Again, O God, our Creator, Sustainer, and Redeemer, we confess our feelings of exile and alienation amid a global pandemic, and we wonder where you are. We fear your absence when, in fact, you are now most present to us. Restore in us a sense of your comfort and care. Renew our strength so that we might mount up with wings like eagles. Hear us now as we silently confess the ways in which we know we've fallen short of living the life you want us to live. Amen. The God who hung the stars and the moon has come close to each and all of us with mercy and love. Hear the good news of the gospel. We are forgiven and empowered by God's Spirit to run and not be weary, to walk and not faint, to sing and laugh in joy. Thanks be to God. Let us be serene because we know God loves us. And as we prepare to hear the words of the scripture read for us, let us pray that that serenity might open our eyes and ears and hearts to his word. Because God loves us, let nothing move us from our peace. Because God loves us, we are those to whom all good has come. Let us be open then, listening, hearing the word God has for us today. Amen.
The Old Testament lesson this morning is Psalm 100, All Lands Summoned to Praise God, a Psalm of Thanksgiving. Make a joyful noise to the Lord, all the earth. Worship the Lord with gladness. Come into his presence with singing. Know that the Lord is God. It is he that made us, and we are his. We are his people and the sheep of his pasture. Enter his gates with thanksgiving and his courts with praise. Give thanks to him. Bless his name. For the Lord is good. His steadfast love endures forever, and his faithfulness to all generations. The word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. The gospel reading this morning is John 17:6 through 19. I have made your name known to those whom you gave me from the world. They were yours, and you gave them to me, and they have kept your word. Now they know that everything you have given me is from you. For the words that you gave me, I have given to them, and they have received them and known in truth that they came from you, and they have believed that you sent me. I am asking on their behalf. I am not asking on behalf of the world, but on behalf of those whom you gave me, because they are yours. All mine are yours, and yours are mine, and I have been glorified in them. And now I am no longer in the world, but they are in the world, and I am coming to you, Holy Father. Protect them in your name that you have given me, so that they may be one as we are one. While I was with them, I protected them in your name that you have given me. I guarded them, and not one of them was lost except the one destined to be lost, so the scriptures might be fulfilled. But now I am coming to you, and I speak these things in the world so that they may have joy made complete in themselves. I have given them your word, and the world has hated them because they do not belong to the world, just as I do not belong to the world. I am not asking you to take them out of the world, but I ask you to protect them from the evil one. They do not belong to the world, just as I do not belong to the world. Sanctify them in the truth. Your word is truth. As you have sent me into the world, so I have sent them into the world. And for their sake, I sanctify myself, so that they also may be sanctified in truth. The gospel of Christ. Thanks be to Christ. The blessing of Almighty God is in the reading, the hearing, the understanding, and the living of his word. Blessed is the name of our God.
Our message this morning is lighten up. Make a joyful noise to the Lord. That's what the psalm says. And in church, we generally interpret joyful noise to mean singing. But even with that understanding, during a hymn sing in non-COVID times, You see a lot of people not singing during a hymn. I know there are a lot of folks who keep silent during a hymn because they think they can't sing. But it says right there in the psalm that you should be making a joyful noise to the Lord. So, and of course this doesn't apply now, but when we're back out of COVID, no excuses. You should be singing. Even if you don't think you can carry a tune, you need to be doing your best to make that joyful noise. Now, my father was deaf in one ear. He could not hold a tune to save his life. He was like those of you who don't sing, except at Christmas time. And then he sang lustily all those words, all those carols. And the people sitting around us in church would occasionally laugh. But you know, he was making a joyful noise, and it was coming from his heart. He was making it joyfully, unabashedly. We all need to do the same, regardless of what other people's response is, whether they laugh or put their hands over their ears. You see, the more you sing, the more you're able to hear your own voice, and the better you get at singing. And while you're perfecting your artful singing, while you're still off key, it's up to those folks around you. It's up to them to drown you out. So you see, by those of you who feel you can't sing, by your singing, you're actually encouraging the rest of them to make a more joyful noise. You are being their benefactor. It's your duty to sing, you see, and it's their duty to drown you out. Making a joyful noise. It doesn't say beautiful noise. It doesn't say a harmonious noise or melodious noise. It says a joyful noise. God loves a joyful noise. God loves a child banging on pots. God loves babbling brooks. God loves the sound of snowflakes falling through trees, chattering squirrels, coyotes howling, and booming thunder. So it doesn't matter how you sing, as long as you do. And when you're able to gather safely, when we're able to get together again, I look forward to hearing you all sing joyfully. What other ways are there to make a joyful noise? When we're not in church, what do we think of as a joyful noise? Laughter. But we don't hear that joyful noise much in church at all. And that's a shame. Again, right now, we can't. But it's something else to look forward to when we're able to get together. We really should laugh more in church, because life is full of craziness, crazy inconsistencies, and God is with us through each of them. And believe me, God is laughing. And our laughter is certainly a joyful noise for God. So in that vein, I'm going to tell you a story. It's a true story. I've told it many times, but a few of you may have heard it, but I think most of you haven't. I'll preface this story by saying that pastors are regular people. They're no more perfect, nor any wiser necessarily than anyone else. It's just that they've focused their reading and studies on God more than most people. And based on those studies and their faithful belief, they try to apply God to present-day situations. It's a tightrope that pastors walk. It's a tightrope that any person who's taken on a leadership role walks. A tightrope you might call responsibility. A shepherd is responsible for the flock. When you write a sermon, you're trying to reach people, trying to make them a bit uncomfortable so that they see the gap between what is normal behavior in the present and what God teaches us that we need to want to achieve, to get us to see things a bit more clearly. That's the purpose. And to give the congregation, hopefully, an aha moment, and so they realize and see a step forward that they can take. You want them to be hearing God through the words of the sermon. And every pastor can tell you about how they've been derailed now and then dealing with unanticipated happenings, usually at the hands of children. But this also can be seen as a reason to rejoice. I started pastoring a little over 20 years ago. Hard to believe it's been that long. Jacob Weilhauer in Lake Huntington needed some time off, and David Kingsley suggested that I might take over a Sunday here and there for him. And so I began preaching a month at a time up in Lake Huntington. Especially since I was just beginning as a pastor, I was concerned about the message and delivering what the congregation would hear and understand from the scripture readings. So I would arrive there each Sunday very apprehensive about how the message was going to be received. The Lake Huntington Church is fairly small. Have any of you been there? About four of their church would fit inside this sanctuary. There are about 20 pews, one center aisle. Its congregation at the time amounted to five or six ladies in their 60s, and they were very good Presbyterians. They all sat in the back two pews. Sometimes they all would fit in the back pew. Easier to escape, I'm sure. So this Sunday of my story, it was five of them and me and the organist, a lovely lady who was in her 80s at least, a little hard of hearing, and she played the organ rather haltingly. She'd find a chord and play it, and then find the next chord and play it. Hymn singing was interesting. You just held out that last note until she found the next chord. But her musical offering made the service complete. This one particular Sunday, I think it was my second or third time there, one of the ladies brought her little granddaughter, who was just learning how to walk. And this little one contented herself by crawling around under the back pews while her grandmother and the others sat in the last pew and attended the service. I was anxious about the sermon, as I always was and still am, really. I'd say a little prayer after I'd put it together, and say it again while I was driving there, and again when I arrived in the parking lot, and again as I started the service. I was anxious. The prayer would be something like, "Dear God, may what I've put together be what you want them to hear, and may they hear what you want them to hear." Over and over I'd pray that. So we began the service. And the ladies were nicely attentive, and the little one was having a grand time underneath the pews. We went through the call to worship, the confession, the scriptures, the haltingly sung hymn, and I got to the point of beginning the sermon. And the cherub started toddling down the center aisle, and it was clear she wanted to talk to me. So I excused myself from the pulpit. I was mic'd. And I went down to meet her at the head of the aisle. And I got down on her level so I could hear her well. And she very seriously looked me square in the eye and said, "Garbage." Well, you can imagine, after all my concern about writing what I hoped God wanted me to present, all sorts of things started racing through my head. God, is this a case of out of the mouths of babes? God, couldn't you have found another way to let me know? Maybe a little sooner? What the heck am I going to do now? All this in just a second or two. And then the little cherub reached out her hand and gave me a candy wrapper she'd found underneath one of the pews. I thanked her and went back up to the pulpit and gave the sermon and the rest of the service. Two things I learned that day. God has a truly wicked sense of humor, and God loves to laugh. I could hear him laughing, big belly laughs at the joke he'd pulled on me. God laughs like a parent laughs at the antics of one just learning to walk. God rejoices in us, that after we flub, after we fall, after we give it what we think is our best and then fail, we get back up and do it again a little better the next time. We sing a bit better, we speak a bit better, we love a bit better, we share our faith a bit better. And in doing that, we spread the love of God, and God loves that. So we should rejoice not only in God, but in ourselves too. Laugh at our antics and rejoice at our progress when those little steps forward are mastered. Knowing that made me feel a lot closer to God. Because the second thing I learned is this: it's not about me. As much as the pastor walks that tightrope and tries to craft the words that will motivate the flock, tries to lead responsibly, it's ultimately not only about the pastor, however perfect or imperfect he or she is. It's not about the person standing up here on Sunday morning delivering the service. It's about you. You are here at God's invitation. God has moved you to be in this temple to worship Him. God has worked through the person standing here at the pulpit to deliver a message to you. But even if you don't hear God's word for you in the message, God will watch over you. Ideally, you'll hear and think and realize a way you can move forward in God to bring yourself closer to God, yes, but also to move the flock closer to being part of the kingdom of God. So because ideally you'll hear the message, listen carefully, think, what moves you from the message? How does it nudge you? What can you do to move that message forward, out beyond these temple walls? God made us and pronounced His creation good. So what could make God happier than making joyful noises, laughing, singing in joy, and working not only for His joy, but also for His good? And someday, by caring for each other, we'll be able to do that again together soon. That we laugh and sing does not mean we take our job lightly. Being a Christian, being a child of God, is serious business. It means fighting injustice, serving the oppressed. It means loving even those we aren't inclined to love. It means caring for each other, even when we don't agree. Caring on the safe side, because if the other is uncomfortable, that is our concern. And in this current age, for the present time, laughing, singing, even speaking in chorus is more dangerous when we're gathered together. But it won't always be that way. We have a lot to look forward to. God knows our hearts. Laughing, singing, speaking in chorus aren't necessary right now for God to know how we long to worship. God loves to rejoice in us. God loves to see us try and get better. This is still the day that the Lord has made, so let us be glad and rejoice in it. Whether you fill this pulpit or simply talk your faith to your friends, whether you're singing in tune or bawling out of tune or singing only in your head, whether you're laughing or quietly listening, whether you're sharing your faith or simply working alongside another, extend yourself in God, making a joyful noise in His name. And when we're able again to be together, let us be so joyful at His presence that we take it out of here and shine that joyful light. The more we can do that, the more people we'll find who will share their light and encourage us in turn. New ideas, new connections, new friends in God, new laughter, new song, a joyful noise indeed. rejoice that we have that to look forward to. I've shared this message with you this morning in the name of Almighty God, the one to whom Jesus pointed as being worthy of our worship and joy. Amen. Hear the words of the institution of the Holy Supper of our Lord Jesus Christ. The Lord Jesus, on the night of his arrest, took bread, and after giving thanks to God, he broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take, eat. This is my body broken for you. Do this in remembrance of me." In the same way, he took the cup, saying, "This is the new covenant, the cup of the new covenant. My blood shed for you, for the forgiveness of sins. Whenever you drink it, do it in remembrance of me. Every time you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the saving grace of the living God until he comes. With thanksgiving, let us offer God our grateful praise. Holy God, we praise you. Let the heavens be joyful. Let the earth be glad. We bless you for creating the whole world, for your promises to your people Israel, and for Jesus Christ, in whom your fullness dwells. Born of Mary, he shares our life. Eating with sinners, he welcomes us. Guiding his children, he leads us. Visiting the sick, he heals us. Dying on the cross, he saves us. Risen from the dead, he gives new life. Living with you, he prays for us. With thanksgiving, we take this bread and this cup and proclaim the death and resurrection of our Lord. Receive our sacrifice of praise. Pour out your Holy Spirit upon us, that this meal may be a communion of the body and blood of our Lord. Make us one with Christ and with all who share in this feast. Unite us in faith. Encourage us with hope. Inspire us to love, that we may serve as your faithful disciples until we feast at your table in glory. We praise you, eternal God. Through Christ, your word made flesh, in the holy and life-giving Spirit, now and forever. Amen. Let us pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. Jesus' body and blood. They are the gifts of God, by the grace of God, for the people of God. Take and eat. Jesus' blood spilled for us. Take and drink. Amen. Please stand for the reading of the Apostles' Creed. Actually, at home, you probably don't have to stand. I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Ghost, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Ghost, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Let us pray. Eternal God, we praise you that in Jesus Christ your kingdom has drawn near and is present even now in our midst. Help us to live as if it were so and bear witness to its presence among us. Galvanize us so that we no longer make our peace with the world as it is, but rather lean into the world as it should be. Awaken us so that we are no longer numb to violence and the suffering of others. Empower us by your Spirit to participate at those points where your reign is struggling toward realization even now. We acknowledge the skepticism in our world and sometimes in our own hearts that your reign is at hand. There have been too many tyrants to name, along with the courts that have enabled them. There have been genocides and slave ships and atrocious horrors. Forgive us for doubting the reality and power of your kingdom, prodding us to live better, to better respect others. Help us to believe in the one who proclaimed its presence among us and who lived and died as if it were so. Empower us by the Spirit that raised him from the dead and that enables us to participate in your life-giving work in the world. Hear our prayers for our friends in need. We ask for your healing of Louise Spencer, and we pray for the family and friends of Artie Jensen, nephew of Walter Jensen. Be with them, dear God, as they mourn. Hear our prayers for the world of nations, for a global community that is suffering under a raging pandemic. We pray that you would grant strength and endurance to medical personnel who continue to tend those who are desperately ill. And Lord, comfort families who are grieving the loss of loved ones. We pray for our own country. Embolden the leadership of our nation to do right and seek justice. And we pray for wise discernment among our elected leaders as they grapple with their current challenges in order to bring us health, healing, peace, and justice. We pray all these things and so much more in the name of your Son, our teacher and guide. Amen. Friends, let your life become your prayer. Let the journeying be a walk with God. Come on a discovery of yourself. The one who calls you to follow will lead you in ways of truth, joy, and peace. Open your hearts to hear his invitation. Laugh and love along with him. And by the grace of God and in the power of the Holy Spirit, go and boldly follow him in faith. Amen.